My name is Belle Chevigny. I'm the chair of the prison writing program. Our winners cannot come here to read for themselves. Tonight, eight of us in the prison writing program will do our best to evoke their presence. But before we begin, we would like to honor Stephen Wayne Anderson. He was executed a year ago in San Quentin on the 29th of January. During his 20 years on death row, Anderson educated himself thoroughly, reading so voraciously that he wrote us that he sometimes dreamed of libraries. Rising at midnight to write in relative quiet, he made himself a writer. He wrote about his disturbed parents, his troubled childhood and vagrant youth, and then about the more than 500 men who lived beside him in California's death row. We carry imminent destruction within us constantly, he wrote. We eat, sleep, and breathe death. Stephen Wayne Anderson used his experience to become what we could call the poet laureate of America's damned.
Like raindrops falling. Over these incarcerated years, I have heard men wail in the night, mourning misplaced lives and lost souls. Most chilling was the sound of a man weeping, his sorrow falling slowly over my awareness like raindrops increasing upon the roof, until it echoed hollow through my mind. Let me tell you, nothing seems as forlorn as the profound crying of an unseen man weeping in solitude.
How I got this ache. Late in the night, I wanted to see the moon, but a wall got in the way. So lying down on the floor sideways, I gazed up through iron bars and wire mesh covered window to behold a full moon uncut by impediments and impositions of the state. There I lay until sleep came, enjoying the unrestricted view. And at dawn I awoke with this sore neck, that unforgiving agony, the moon's revenge for my spying.
This poem was written in the perhaps 6 weeks before the execution of Stephen Anderson. Sleep, perchance a dream, it's called. None of this is real, I tell myself. This is a bad dream. None of this is real. Not the glistening needle, not the pungent smell of alcohol, not the odor of fake leather over soft cushioned straps, not the quick jab of pain, not the dread dragging me down, not the smell of rot and the grave, and not these things, like claws reaching up, tearing off pieces of me as I fall away into none of this is real. But it is. And I tell myself, go to sleep. Dream and wake. Go sleep, I tell myself. Just go.
5 days before Stephen Anderson's execution, they took him out of his cell, stripped him virtually naked, and took away his last piece of paper and last pencil. But as he walked out of that cell, he handed his lawyer this poem called The Last Poem I Will Write. What is this we do except what was done? Tomorrow, a bright sun burns away those sullen mists left behind by vanishing darkness. What is all this except an afterthought? Tomorrow, the sun shines, while a sleeping moon dreams of once again rising. Now let's turn to the Penn Prison Writing winners for 2003. We'll begin with the first prize in poetry, a poem called The Nature of Things by Gordon Grills from Florence, Arizona. Jackson Taylor will read.
The green iguana on my wall has closed his eyes as if asleep or lost in some ancient jungle reverie. Sky and wind moving over primordial waters, days without end in the canopy of the rainforest. I have come to this desert alone, slipping quietly across the border from another state of mind, watching the Sonoran sunset. My eyes follow a white-winged dove to its nest in a Palo Verde. During the night, monsoon rains move in from Mexico. In my dreams, you are always alive. You call to me across the arroyo, but the wind steals your words. I try to speak, but 20 years of goodbyes have left me with nothing to say. A man in shackles measures his step against the chains that hold him and learns to move with his limitations. We are pilgrims, finding our way, learning the lesson the turtle teaches to the fish. Sadness borrows my soul. I lost myself even before I lost you.
William Wisely, who was imprisoned in Ione, California, won an honorable mention in drama for his play, Someone to Listen.
So, what's your problem?
What isn't?
Why are you here?
I'm 22, I've been down 5 years, I got life, end of story.
How's your sleep?
Lousy. It's the noise, radios, TVs, some ass yelling up to his homie all fucking night about nothing. Starts up again at breakfast. Can't hear yourself chew.
Anything more?
More? What do you want me to say? I'm 22, my life's over. I live in a big fucking bowl full of assorted fruits and nuts.
You seem angry.
Really? They taught you that in school, huh? Yeah, I'm angry. I'm angry I got caught. I'm angry that my public defender was a drunken idiot. Lady split as soon as I got sentenced, but most of all, I'm angry that you dragged me in here to ask me all these stupid fucking questions.
It's William, right?
No, I'm John.
How's everything going for you?
Great, couldn't be better. Things are just great. I've been down 15 years. My mother died 6 months ago. No one bothered to tell me for 3 weeks. Everything and everyone I had outside is gone. And how are you?
How are you getting along with your cellmate?
He stumbles off his bunk at the last minute for chow, never bothers to wash his hands or brush his teeth first, comes back, crawls right under the covers again. Hadn't changed his clothes or sheets for so long, I lost track. When he's awake, he talks to himself, farts, and giggles. His boxers have green shit streaks smeared all over the back. He smells like cold vomit. How'd you like being pinned up in a small space with that, Doc?
Would you like us to arrange for someone different?
Like who? If they're not nuts, they're gay. If they're not gay, they're dope fiends. If they're not dope fiends, then they're cutting up the fucking lockers to make shanks. I woke up to one cell to stop. You know any reasonably sane, clean, respectful prisoner who isn't already cell dope with someone permanently?
And so?
And so, the better the nut I know than taking a chance of getting someone even worse.
Are you in any of our therapy groups?
For what?
We found that men incarcerated as long as you begin to need special attention.
Special attention? That's what you call it? You mean medication, right? Half the yard's all spaced out on your Skittles. They give them out by the handfuls in Medline, colorful little pills that numb the mind and slowly corrode the brain. I ain't going out like that. Thanks anyway.
We help them cope?
Help them? I'm interested in helping them. You medicate them into zombies so they're easier to manage. The donut-sucking guards just herd them around like so many cows. Well, those guys gave up. I could do that. Sure, it'd be easy to just let go. I have nothing to look forward to except dying in this cesspool. Nothing you do well is valued here. Nothing you say or think is important. You're not even a man. You're an inmate. Something that can be kicked around without feeling guilty. It'd be easy to let go. But I won't.
And your name is?
John. My name is John.
You've been with us quite a while, yeah?
35 years.
That's a long time. How are you doing?
I'm dying.
Dying?
Cancer.
And your family? John, is it?
Gone. All gone.
How long have you...
Got before I die? 5-6 months, I guess.
And there's no one? Surely some friend?
Well, there's no one. I haven't had a visitor in a long time.
How are you sleeping? You need to...
Terribly, terribly. I'm sleeping terribly. And no, I don't need anything to help me sleep. It's the dreams. Every night, the dreams.
What dreams?
Different each night, but the same. I mean, no matter where I'm at in the dream, I'm in prison. I never dream about being free. I don't remember what that was like, being free. I remember, though, I remember people listened.
They what? They listened, you say?
They listened to me. Like what I had to say was important. Not like in here, you know. Nobody gives a shit about me or what I might say. Prisoners are so self-centered, they've lost the ability to care. Staff don't care. They see us as walking turds. The whole place is just so they can get a paycheck. Too scared to steal. Too lazy to get a real job. And too stupid to go to school. That's what really is... That's what scares me. Yeah, that's right. Dying in a place where no one listens, no one cares. But there's people all around me all the time. I haven't had the privacy in 35 years, but I feel alone. Empty. I'll be dead soon. Maybe I'll die in my cell. Maybe they'll put me in the infirmary in a strip cell with nothing to do but stare at the dirty walls day and night. There's so much more I'd like to say, Doc. So much more to know before that happens. I just need someone to listen. Someone who won't make me feel invisible, like I'm already a ghost. You know what I mean. Right, Doc? 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 You know, don't you?
Last year, the Penn Prison Writing Committee initiated a new prize in the name of our late beloved colleague, Fielding Dawson. Fielding always felt that we should reward new serious writers who were testing out their voices for the first time. This year, the Fielding Dawson Award went to Julia Averett, who wrote from prison in Dayton, Texas. On January 31st, 2003, she was released. Her piece is called The Homing Pigeon, and it will be read by Susan Rosenberg, who was a many-time winner in four of our genres in the past.
The Homing Pigeon. Earlier in the year, which is 2002, around May or June, I was working outdoors with the inmate yard crew here, and when we returned to the yard shed, we found a pigeon caught on the razor wire, which encircles the maintenance yard within the prison yard next to our shed. So the sergeant here and one of the yard bosses retrieved a big, long broom used for getting cobwebs off the tall ceilings in the dorms and finally knocked the bird off the razor wire. He fell back into the maintenance yard. The next 2 days, when I returned to work, I saw the bird still inside the yard. A few inmates thought the cats here on the unit would eventually find him. Later, I asked a girl in the kitchen for some bread, and she gave me half a loaf. As I was throwing the bread over the high fence, I attracted quite a few of the inmates I worked with, and one of the maintenance workers came out into the yard. We asked her to try to throw the bread by the bird to see if he would eat it. It didn't work. He wasn't interested. So one girl asked the maintenance girl to try and bring us the bird to see the extent of his injuries. He didn't look too bad. He seemed to be healing nicely. One girl noticed a couple of bands on his feet, and another girl said it was a homing pigeon, and that owners register their birds with the Texas Department of Parks and Wildlife. But we figured he would soon fly home after he healed. Well, since we attracted all this attention, a few girls who worked in the commissary and the woman who ran the store walked by. One of the girls was inquiring about the bird. On their way back, she told us that she had talked her boss into getting and calling the Parks and Wildlife. So the woman picked up the bird, and a little while later, we went to commissary, as we do, to get the boxes loaded on a truck. While we were there, we were told that the ranger from Parks and Wildlife had come and taken the bird, and that the bird was now on his way home to Austin, Texas, which from our location at LJ Plain State Jail in Dayton, Texas, would be a good 2 or 3 hour trip. It made me think back on a time around 1992 when my husband, then now ex, and I owned a duck. We kept it in a big cardboard box in the bathroom. One day we were gone for a while. I don't remember how long or where we were, but I remember telling him, "I wonder if the duck was wondering where we were." And he replied, "Ducks don't wonder." And now, thinking about what the pigeon must have thought when he arrived home to his family, I bet the owner felt his efforts to register his birds paid off too. But as far as birds not wondering, I think different.
Eric Waters, who has also won prizes in four genres in the past, will now read from Eric Reed's prize-winning poetry, She Makes Me Feel. Eric Reed won an honorable mention for this poem, which he wrote in Attica, New York.
She makes me feel I've become an onion man, covering feelings beneath layers of mean personalities and clenched, warlike fists. With deliberate sinister glances and gangster dip in my walk, danger is conveyed to those versed in body language. Men with death in their faces read my classic script well, being clones themselves of the same. Proving I worship hatred, they grant me distance to live. Feelings of life elude us, who stink in onion layers. There's one who makes me feel, one who walks through my resistance. I tremble before her innocent presence. At birth, she smiled, waving tiny fingers. I vow then to serve her, wanting sons as symbols of strength. She came as a symbol of beauty. But oh, when I think of her, the bolted doors ease open. When she calls me father, my stink fades away. My layers softened, shed, disappear.
Where Fields Have Been Planted is the title of a poem by Kyle D. Sharp of Florence, Arizona. Ethan Bumas will read it for us.
In my mind, lonely for my father, I walk where fields have been planted. Remember the plow turning the dark earth. Imagine cows grazing in an adjacent pasture. The sun slanting over the hills, rolling under the earth at night. Since his heart gave out, I think of him more often, as if there were nourishment in death, as if a process of endarkenment were healthful for the soul. Check the fences, kneel down to look into a culvert, walk the empty barn that has no windows, a door at each end, like a tunnel through which the slanted sun shines.
Marie Ponceau will read the third prize in poetry, which this year goes to Dominique Ramsey in Dublin, California, for her poem, Observations by Self.
Milky white, the poet sees beyond the paper. The blue lines are a map or a Bible. Draw strength from go-go boots or corn. Make a way to find the pathway back. Play back the photos of your courage. Guide yourself by moonlight past madness. I fought all day with myself. Forgiveness is only saying, screw it, truly. Hair, it's only worth is shampoo and tangles. Your glory is not tongue-tied, rubber-banded. Winter is confining with paralyzing chills. Magnolias float 3 days, giving fragrance.
In Tennessee Colony, Texas, Jorge Antonio Renault has won third prize in fiction for a collection of short fictions in progress called The Restlessness of Bound Wrists.
The curtain over the window into the room where the man would die was white. Beth was dismayed by its cotton plainness. She thought it should scream attention to itself, to the window and the room beyond, to its blessed purpose as the place where Amado's killer would cough and spit out his life. Amado had not wanted to go to the dance. He had cut grass all weekend, inundated by the response to the leaflets he'd pushed under doors and taped to windows. The ads showed a stick figure, Amado el Flaco, pushing an old-fashioned mower, its blades whirring, quiet and pollution-free, a selling point in environmentally aware Austin. Amado cut grass for pocket money. Beth believed he was upset that he was still in school while she worked, and the labor made him feel better. She didn't care. "You pay the bills, amor, so let me buy the popcorn and cokes, eh?" he'd laughed, and hauled the mower away, not knowing she drove by now and then just to look at him. Beth knew he was saving for carpentry tools. He sawed crookedly, like he mowed, she remembered, as she cursed the white plain curtains. But he was determined to craft wooden furniture and toys for their daughter. "I'll measure her little colita," he said, "and make a rocking chair for her, and a horse, and a little dollhouse for her pinche Barbies and Kennys. To hell with toys or them. And I'll make her a little hammer with foam so she can practice hammering on stuff, so she can help me, see?" His desire for a daughter astounded her. Beth thought it was because she'd expressed her own yearning time and again. Beth knew Chicanos, and they all wanted sons, junior machitos in their own image, but not Amado. "I'll teach her to throw a curve, and she can be the first woman to pitch in the majors," he said one night after the Astros lost again. "She'll be a lefty and come out of the bullpen, mija, spitting sunflower seeds on the rug, beaning some guy and kicking him when he charges the mound, baboso." He rolled on top of Beth, furious at a slugger with the temerity to swing at their daughter. "Let's get her going, babe," said her amado, el romántico. She thought he missed the excitement and swirl of the dances, and she surprised him with tickets when little Joe came to the Coliseum. He went because she wanted him to, tired as he was, with grass stains on his knuckles. They danced polkas and rancheras, and as always, he stumbled on the cumbias. He bumped into a woman, and she cursed his awkwardness and was not mollified by his humility, neither she nor her date, who knifed Amado, and he drowned in his blood as his daughter slept in Beth's belly, and Beth would not stoop to forgive the roaring emptiness that night left in her life. Molly was born 2 weeks after Amado's killer was sentenced to die. His first appeal was denied a week before she turned 2. The week of her 4th birthday, his second appeal was rejected. He was to die today as Molly turned 7. Beth marveled at the synchronicity of it, how the dates stumbled one over the other, the tears of one tied to the celebrations of the other. Beth had met the mother of Amado's killer and grieved with her over entwined losses. The old woman had lost another, older son to gang wars. Beth told her she still wished the younger son dead and would kill him herself if she could. The old woman gaped at Beth, tears running into the wrinkles cushioning her mouth. But Beth believed the woman understood, if anyone did, how clearly rang the crystal of Beth's rage. Her friends told her to live for Molly, to let go and forgive Amado's killer. All the stuttering consolations the whole extend to the halved. "Fuck that," she whispered as the other witnesses filed into the room. Beth had never felt, never, that she was diminished by her desire to see Amado's killer die, or that she had to let go. But she did not brood over the past. She did not live for revenge. She did not agitate for the death penalty or join victims' groups. She simply wanted, with every cell and memory of her being, that Amado's killer join him in the nothingness of death. She did not want him to have one moment with his mother, or one kiss with his wife, or one smell of his daughter, and she would not hide those feelings or pretend otherwise. So when the white curtains parted, she pressed to the glass and watched unblinkingly as the drugs flowed into the arms of Amado's killer. And after he fouled himself and died, Beth walked into the moonlit parking lot, past the shoving reporters, and drove home to Amado's daughter and her birthday party.
Those were fictions from Texas. Now from Florida's Death Row, we have the first prize winner for nonfiction essay, a piece called My Turn by William Van Poyck.
In 1972, serving life for a Miami robbery and tutored by an ex-judge doing life for double murder, I dedicated myself to studying law. Infused with the Pangalosian confidence of a neophyte and the fervor of a zealot, convinced of the inherent justness of the system, I set out on my odyssey. In 1988, my own personal tides propelled me to death row. For my part, in a botched attempt to free a friend from a prison transport van in downtown West Palm Beach, during which my co-defendant shot a prison guard. I celled close to Frank Smith for 10 years. Crazy as Hamlet, Frank was easily overlooked and looked down upon by prisoners and staff alike. Frank shuffled around FSP in quiet desperation, ostracized for a crime he said he did not commit. In his deepest moments of private pain, Frank sometimes came to me, painfully deferential, his taped-up state eyeglasses framing a face without happiness or anticipation of any, clutching tattered legal papers as indecipherable to him as a Mandelstam poem. I would patiently explain the merits of his lawyer's latest motion, even as I blithely assumed his guilt. I should have known better. I can still hear Frank's gravelly voice, like a refrain in a minor key, reaching up through his psychosis, claiming his innocence with the same passionate articulation he employed to proclaim himself a messenger of God. Perhaps he was innocent. People were, Frank assured me, plotting on him. Perhaps they were. Who would listen? In January 2000, Frank Smith, stricken by cancer, still enduring his own solitude, quietly died on the other side of truth. 10 months later, the FBI released its DNA report, conclusively excluding Frank. The Assistant Attorney General expressed shock and dismay that she had so earnestly sought the execution of an innocent man for so many years. I was certain he was guilty, she lamented. The case has been reopened. 14 years ago, I stood up in a West Palm Beach courtroom to demand the then nascent DNA testing that could conclusively establish I was not the trigger man. The bloody clothes remain untested. Though the state now belatedly concedes I was not the shooter, they vigorously occupied the opposite position at trial, and I was sentenced to death by a jury and judge who believed them. You need not study law for 28 years to discern the common threads in the warp and woof of this fabric. Cases like Pop, Earl, and Frank are as common and as close as yesterday's Chicago Tribune, today's Newsweek, or tomorrow's segment of Nightline. Between them all lies a continuum of consequences. People inexplicably confess to crimes they did not commit. Innocent people occupy death row. DNA tests go unconducted. To remain silent is to speak the lie of acquiescence. Who will listen?
Any man or woman in an American jail or prison can submit a poem, an essay, a story, a memoir, or a play to the pen contest. Guidelines to the contest may be found on the pen website, www.pen.org. Any prisoner may write to pen at 568 Broadway, Suite 401, New York, New York 10012, for a free manual on writing. Our anthology, Doing Time, 25 Years of Prison Writing, published by Arcade, may be ordered through the website www.doingtime.org. Thanks again for listening.